then force your comp to be made around the LeBlanc. Maybe just look for the counter pick, look for a later round choice, and just assess things differently.
Well, we are into champ select for game number two here. M3, of course, upper game here in this best of two series, but Nunu's going to be the first ban there for Master 3. Vladimir actually banned out by RNG. Didn't really like what Dade did in the last game.
And that's one of the reasons why we see multiple bans coming towards Dade in general, Pastry Time, is that people kind of perceive him to have 3 to 4 champions at any time. So with 3 bans, maybe you can force him out of comfort. So will he prove this season that that's a misnomer, that he has multiple power picks? RNG the first to ask the question. Shown prominence on Vlad? Vlad banned first.
Yep, banned away there. LeBlanc actually banned away as well, so some respect to Xiaohu. Azir, interestingly, banned away on the red side, so M3.
3 mid lane champions now.
I don't know if Dade plays Cassiopeia, but if they don't want a banner and RNG don't, that is a potential pickup as well.
I think you'd be forgiven on RNG for saying that you probably don't think he plays Cassiopeia. It was actually one of the questions for Pawn in MSI, is that everyone was confident that given the Azir Cassiopeia prominence, he'd played both those champions but not really shown any prominence, and then he came in with a carry performance on Azir, for example. The question now is, does Dade play Cassio? I think they've answered it, no.
Yeah, banned it away there on the blue side. Don't want that in the pool for either team here, and obviously don't want to first pick it. RNG have a ban left. Do they want to shoot another mid laner? It's Rek'Sai, actually, their choice there, but that's still 4 mid lane bans in this game.
4 mid lane bans and a very strong ganking jungle. It leaves open Kalista. Now, Snake had this same option. Do we pick up Kalista for Crystal, or do we go for a jungle like Rek'Sai? They chose the jungle route, so the Kalista priority wasn't as high for them. SMLZ, it's not Candy, who styled upon people as Kalista earlier last season, but still is another noted Kalista player. They value it very high. 80 carry at first pick.
Yeah, that's going to give Gragas over to RNG, who have already locked it in there for the jungle. Maka would be a smart takeaway there as well, if that's what they want to take as well. Maka is super flexible, great in so many situations, and was understandably one of Looper's first choices, but then a couple more options here as well.
I would have expected the Hecarim to be the answering pick to the Maokai, so if he does just opt into Hecarim, probably going to still be the Hecarim-Maokai matchup. Looper's played some Gnar, it hasn't necessarily been the stronger of his champions, but Zatai showed just what you can do if you build for lane and happily blow a Hecarim away with the Black Cleaver or the Frozen Mallet. In that case, both, because he's just a baller was Zatai. Tie in that previous game. Wait and see what the jungle pickup is. Probably going to be the Maokai, though. These are the options. The Maokai is definitely trying to match early power for late power in terms of a much earlier power spike for the Maokai and a much later power spike for the Hecarim. It's just a more reliable lane swap champion. We've seen Hecarim versus Maokai, what, for 2 months now running. Has been a very confident top lane matchup. And Lee Sin, yeah. Our first Lee Sin of the split.
That's a change-up. I mean, both these junglers known for Lee Sin play. Practically every jungler actually in the LPL. Even Clearlove known for Lee Sin play at some point in the last season. But Lee Sin, Maokai have the next few pickups. And in a Cinderhawk meta, Lee Sin's fallen completely away. So to have M3 pick it up here is curious. Is Orianna already locked in for Xiaohu?
Insta-locked by Xiaohu, doing his best God V impression with the insta-lock Orianna. Lots of options left to Dade, of course. Orianna, very strong laning champion, very reliable, but it opens up many different matchups. Will he opt into a counter matchup again? I almost want to see the Zed come through and just go for the skill matchup in mid, but any control champion is open to him to face off against the Orianna.
I just realized he actually could pick Yasuo here as well, as Alistar is a big up for RNG. I only realized because the Lee Sin's already locked away, so if that's what they want, they can take it away, but we'll see what M3 wants to take
you
away.
Really want to see I Yasuo.
Dade's Yasuo?
100% win rate in 2015.
That's true. Dade does have 100% win rate on the champion with exactly one game.
Hey man, statistics.
They do not lie. You are correct. There is Thresh actually a consideration, one of Love City and Layim's or Lay's big champions in the last season as well. Has seen quite a bit of play. Not quite the same love as maybe Alistar or Nautilus in recent matchups, but M3 do have a couple more picks to make. Dade might upset me here with a different pickup, but we've seen a lot of this style. You mentioned control meters already. Dade going to match control for control. Thresh to pick up there on support, and it is Xerath in the mid lane.
When you look at the RNG lineup, they've got multiple different ways to disperse a fight. They've got the Hecarim ultimate with the Terrify. They've got the Gragas ultimate for the displacement. Headbutt, Pulverize, and the Shockwave. I think given how team fights were going to come out for M3, it would have been too risky to go for the Yasuo. Very unlikely there was going to be clumping on either side of the team, of the Rift. So going for the Xerath, going for the pure long-range option, can actually poke out Orianna in lane. She has to definitely, usually has to opt into standing in a queue to be able to wave clear herself. It's probably the safest option, but it's probably going to lead to the super-powered Sivir Hecarim combo. And in general, RNG, have a very good answering combo for the Zera.
Yeah, they sort of snuck away with this draft, which was really smart. I mean, to get last pick Sivir with these specific champions all paired up, RNG must feel really comfortable with the picks that they've made here, but M3 gonna keep it a bit different. I mean, comfort picks for them, for sure. The Lee Sin's the biggest flag for me, because how much work can you get done in a Cinderhulk meta? Clear Love's shown that you can still do it. Some of the really aggressive junglers like it, but for the most part, being replaced by Gragas or other junglers, it's just your early game's great and then it falls off real quick.
And the reason why they've opted into this Lee Sin is to look for early game power. That's the only reason I can come across, because Lee Sin certainly can build Cinderhulk, but doesn't really fit into his build. It's a risky pick, and the Xerath towards the end of the draft is super risky, given the fact that you can read down these names. The likes of Sivir, Gragas, and Alistar, all great champions, are getting onto the backline, all of them empowered by the Sivir on the hunt. It is, as you mentioned, surprising to see them sneak away a Sivir pick at the end. But in terms of getting onto an immovable mage, they've got multiple options.
They do. I mean, I like the laning matchup for Jade. Sure. I think classically Orianna Ziggs was a big Ziggs matchup there that was in his favor. And Xerath, not quite the same champion, but does have similarities there. So I like what Dado's doing here. He's actually picking himself into at least a soft counter here, not the soft.
The lane matchup is fine. It's just that everyone else, the team fights, is looking hairy, to say the least.
Yes, and I mean, M3, they got ahead in the last game and were assertive in the mid game. Condi, who did quite a bit of work on Rek'Sai in the last game, going to have to be even more, applying even more pressure in this particular game.
And that's the thing. Late game 5v5 fights, we can't really see how M3 will navigate around them. It's on a champion like Lee Sin, who can take over games. Clearlove showed it best towards the end at last split, to really equalize that point and get an unassailable lead for Master 3 in the early game. That's not to say that there's no scenario where you win a late game fight. It's just, it's too tricky to really execute. It'd be execution heavy to a fault for Master 3.
And M3, at least in the last game, we saw a lot of objective focus and smart team fighting around those objectives. It wasn't necessarily, you know, really high mechanical, very high execution comps that won them game number one. Just to let you know as well, we are remaking the game. Same picks and bans, but it seems like one of the players maybe couldn't swap a champion or something similar. So they'll get picking back through. We'll get shortly onto the Rift, but I think we already said it. I think Royal won this draft handily.
I think Royal won the draft, but let's just talk about the champions that Master 3 have put together. Kalista, 2-item power spike. Maokai, 1.5-item power spike. Lee Sin, definitely strongest in the early parts of the game. If you can get this game snowballing, get a big objective lead, have the Xerath for a little bit of late game insurance, even though there's multiple ways to deal with them in the perfect positioning world, can do a lot of heavy lifting in the late. It's going to be on Master 3 trying to snowball this game out of the reach of RNG. If RNG get this Hecarim rolling, if the Gragas can really start to pressure the lanes, honestly, it feels like Gragas versus an inferior version of Gragas in Lee Sin, which is just a sad thing to say about one of the most popular champions in the league, one of the most popular picks in the LPL in the first split. I think there's a lot of reasons for RNG to be happy, but it's not landslide that Master 3 will lose this game on draft.
No, and if they're playing like they did in the last game, I think they can navigate just fine here. So matchups again, there's Lee Sin versus Gragas. Condi going to be back on an old favorite of his, and Dade, I believe we have seen some of his Xerath in the last season, but Xiaohu, something he found late comfort on in Orianna.
I mean, Dade was Shurima only as well for a long part there. Azir and Xerath made up most of his champion, but he can definitely wave clear with the best of them. As in the bottom lane, more Alistar. Didn't work out so well in game one, but if you start winning, Alistar's almost like a snowball support champion, because whether it's in lane with engages or roaming, very, very powerful on the CC front.
I mean, do you think there's value to maybe that lane swap? Because we talked about it last game, could have had the option there.
I think there's options too. I don't think it's a requirement in this particular game, but it's always a flexible option.
Well, we'll see just how flexible they can be as we're about to get straight into game number one. And welcome onto the Rift here for game number two, excuse me, not game number one, between M3 and RNG. Master 3 currently up a game after a very strong and convincing performance in game number one, but Royal never give up. Some familiar faces, but certainly a new lineup for them as far as the full five players go, and we'll see, can they make an impression here in game number two?
And Kalista Thresh, very fast speeding to the top lane, so blue side lane top looks to be the picture. You seem to have the inside read on that one, Pastry Time, trying to avoid the Sivir vs. Thresh, Kalista matchup. At level 1, it can actually go very well for Kalista, but from level 2 onwards, it can be a bit of a struggle. So both sides invading the red side jungles, And it looks like a lane salt will start off the proceedings.
Yeah, we'll see some wards being put down here. Four trinkets already used by RNG, but M3 going to try and place theirs a bit deeper. Almost all of them down, though, and they'll get some strong vision around here as well. You can see a couple red pings there for RNG, spotting the wards going down, I believe. So having an idea of where M3 might currently be hiding.
I think that it's all pretty clear what happens at this point. And then because you have the wards down, it's much safer to start on the enemy red side than return to your own jungle because you don't have any vision around. It's all become fairly predictable in the jungle following the vertical jungling meta. But at present point, Maokai and Lee Sin setting up around the wolves.
Yeah, Woosh actually running towards the mid side of the map. Now we'll get spotted moving in towards the top. So successful swap there for M3 if that's what they wanted. Was kind of a bluffing game there towards the end, but Maokai going to get a camp. We're going to have Kondi. Where is Kondi? Down the bottom side, going to start there. So Looper going to actually steal away maybe a couple creeps there with saplings.
The bluffs have been strong today. We actually saw this Atlas and I in the previous series, a situation where you basically put everything into a lane swap, you know that there's only 1 minute wards down, the wards time out, and then you can just re-swap back and still get the favorable matchup you're looking for. Because now on the blue side, you've swapped back, you've got the dragon control, and you've avoided the lane that was looking a bit hairy.
Yeah, you can see LoveCity there as well, trying to get a bit of harassment done down there in the jungle, but Looper will join in with Kondi after the red buff goes down, and they'll start the double jungle. So lane swap has been started here, and both junglers are going to end up on the left-hand side of the map.
So Gragas was able to take the blue buff on his side of the jungle. There's no blue buff to be taken, so given that Alistar's roaming, it looks like it might actually potentially be a three buff start for RNG. Very smart map movements and jungle pathing from MLXG and friends.
I mean, a bit of a mistake there, I think, from M3. They knew that they were on that side of the jungle, so you have to think that if I've taken my red and they've got their blue, I have to go to my blue, but maybe just afraid of being outnumbered there. And you're right, it will be a three buff start for Royal Never Give Up.
Look, they might have gotten away from going and rush into their own blue, but it would have been risky. Alistar had already left the top lane. They were going to be outnumbered. Basically, Kondi has given up a buff to get this lane swap successful. So while we might say good bluff, the counterpoint is Lee Sin, a jungler who we've already noted has to make a lot of impression in the early game, is going to be denied a fast level 3, and in general, may not be much of a ganking threat if he's always half a level or a level behind Gragas.
Well, you can see Sivir kind of break the swap pretty quickly here as starting to fast push down the turret. We've got three people, though, rushing towards the top side of the map as well. Going to see what work they can get. And it's actually 3v3 right now on the top side, and Woosh has to be a little bit careful, but Lei is going to come in for the dive. It's 4v3 now. Hook lands for LoveCity. Let Me, though, not going to get in tower range, and Looper trying to clear out what he can, but Kondi's also off to the side. Dade even going to roam in here as well.
Shades of QG versus LGD yesterday. There was an expert turret dive in that match, but RNG have been forced to back away, so no turret dive. It was looking with the Alistar, with the Gragas, so much instant guaranteed CC, they might go for the turret dive, but they all back away. So good job by Dade in particular to rotate without Ghost and actually dissuade the turret dive.
Yeah, smart stuff. Just pokes them off and, dissuades them, from diving in that particular situation. Is pretty even on CS there as well. Woosh, SMLZ, keeping the wave fairly close to home. So doesn't quite have as much CS as Woosh has been fast pushing, but we'll catch up and just be fine here. This is exactly the situation early game that Kalista wants to be in.
Doesn't have a lot of CS, just let me, but picked up the blue buff for a very quick level too. So it's going to be able to match the experience that Looper's picked up, but certainly not the CS. 16 is actually very, very competitive.
Yeah, good babysit here from LoveCD, just keeping Looper in this lane. Lei right now, we've talked about it. Alistar in a 2v1 situation or a 2v2, not that handy. So I'm surprised that he stayed in the lane, but I guess after the dive, he just thought he kind of belongs here.
I mean, you think about that, you might think, okay, so Thresh has equalized and moved to the top to help the pressure for Maokai. The issue is Alistar goes to bottom. Doesn't really do a lot for Letme. They're still fiercely melee. They have some all-in options and a bit of sustain, but the 2v2 there won't help anymore. So, again, it's just the reality of Alistar. If you swap around his weaknesses instead of amplifying his strengths, you get these situations where he just doesn't really achieve a lot.
No, I think start roaming maybe with MLXG is the other option you can have here. Got plenty of good CC. Dade's a fine target there in the mid lane, but instead of just sit in the mid side, but that the top side, but of course that does give again. Looper now 22-7 CS.
He hasn't even been able to put down any wards. There's three blue defensive wards for M3 around Maokai that Thresh put down, but no such vision from Alistar. Doesn't have enough gold from boots. He's thought about challenging the back a couple of times, but hasn't been able to pull it away. So you're right, Lay, unfortunately, he's just sapping experience at this point.
Yeah, getting a bit of XP, not too bad, but Condi starting to get some jungle camps down. Does smite the Wolf will spot. Let Me actually was coming around level 4, but Thresh is back down to the bottom. So now on MLXG, aggressively in the other side of the jungle, but Looper, again, I think knew he was getting dives, just avoided it once again, gone back and got himself another Doran's Rune.
It's actually quite smart of Lee Sin to be jungling on this side of the jungle, because it means that Let Me, he's got the smite, so you might think, okay, if the lane's being frozen, he can exit, smite some camps, and get some extra gold. There's no camps for him to get.
Yeah, Condi, I mean, sticking on the side where they've got power as well, even going to move down and maybe try and force some sort of lane, push here. Instead, Love City freezing the wave very tightly there around that turret, just trying to buy as much time as they can. So no rush here for M3, at least for the dual lane.
Yeah, very smart from Love City. We always see this situation where people rush to a lane in a lane to try and get the freeze. That's all Love City is doing, is ensuring that when the mini wave finally breaks, it's going to aggro onto the nearest target, because of course it's been aggroed just onto Thresh himself. Aggro's onto the nearest minion, and the push and freeze will continue.
Yeah, but although Let Me does get some good CS there, they're trying to buy SMLZ some back timing. Did go back and get a BF sword, so Hecarim going to get a bit of experience in CS, but does have to be careful in that 1v1 now, and you can see Lay starting to move around a bit more with the jungler. These two in tandem, really deadly in a gank.
They're very strong, but as you mentioned, Kalista has that big BF sword pickup in the right spot to pick up Dragon, so they're trying to get as much vision around the Dragon to negate the fact that the shop is coming much quicker for SMLZ, whereas M3, because they've had this dual lane down bottom, they're kind of priced in and feel forced to actually pick up this first Dragon.
SMLZ takes so many minion hits there just to keep the wave in the right spot, and it's great knowledge of the game there from the AD carry, but they are dedicated to getting Kalista this early farm.
It tells you they're dedicated to get the free zone more than it is to pick up objectives, even though we've mentioned the fact that with the likes of Lee Sin, Maokai, and Thresh, their power spikes are much earlier. You feel like if RNG get a secondary win condition, it's not just pull it late and have the compositional advantage. If it's pull it late and have a fifth dragon to shoot for, that's maybe too many eggs in the pile for RNG. But for now, Master 3, you can see, much more interested in freezing the wave.
Yeah, lots of control here as well. Dandy, continuing to push Xiaohu in into the mid lane. 10 CS ahead as well on the Xerath, so using that soft counter matchup quite nicely.
SMLZ continues the freeze, and Alistair's doing Alistair things. He's sticking back and not achieving much.
He's chilling out. I mean, Lay at this point needs his ultimate maybe to be relevant in the next big fight, and he's quite far away from that, sitting at level 4. In fact, Condi might have been fancy the 3v3, and I think with the BF sword and the Fates call ready, M3 are right to pick a fight here.
It's smart that Condi just continues to stay around this thing, because he's suspecting. You'd expect Woosh to be calling in the jungle and saying, look, man, I can't even farm. I'm forced back. You're expecting pressure from the enemy jungler, but not even on the same side of the map is MLXG, and things will just continue to get worse for Sivir. Actually has to roam out of lane and maybe look to pick up the Scuttlecrab.
Yeah, you can see Looper in the top side as well. We actually had the swap back, which I only just noticed given that Woosh had walked down. Scuttlecrab does go to them, so a good bit of golden vision there for a couple seconds there for Royal Never Give Up. Looper ahead in this lane. Let Me should start to get his way back in though, but might struggle a bit here and just kind of take the CS as it comes under his turret.
Look, it's going to keep pushing in. Obviously doesn't have to worry about the threat of Maokai when it comes to any damage. Condi's on the Lee Sin, but is going to be building Cinderhulk Lee Sin. So the kill pressure on dives, it's always there with the base values coming through from Condi, but it's not really massive like it would be if the Warrior Enchant was the first picker.
And I'd be so curious to see if Condi had gotten an early edge in this game. What's his tipping point for maybe getting the Warrior Enchant? Because like Rek'Sai, that flexibility, just such a good thing to have here on a champion like Lee Sin.
And there's a reason why Spirit of the Elder Lizard, now Warrior Enchant, has always been the choice for Lee Sin. It's so slot effective. It's one damage item that really helps, but there's a lot of action.
Fates Call moving in there. Let Me's actually down as well. SMLZ, good flash, gonna keep him safe for now. Hops around there, trying to do what he can. Onto Woosh, actually outplays him almost. Sivir gets the first blood. Orianna down here now as well, but Lay gets a headbutt in, looks for the pulverize, doesn't find it. Xiaohu misses his shockwave after the flash. He tried to get Love City so bad. And five people in the bottom lane, only one kill.
They chose not to roam down. In the end, probably wouldn't have done much. SMLZ is way out of position. He's looking for the assassin. They walk through multiple wards though.
Yeah, they've actually got the ults down, but doesn't hit a single ball onto Woosh. I believe he was pretty safe with Orianna there anyway. Does give them control over the dragon if they want it, but Condi, not quite rushing it down, although is going to start it up now.
Dante was flying blind and walked over two red side wards, so it was really going to be optimistic to a fault in that situation. Wouldn't have got any severe turret damage down. Condi's smart. He comes through an area where he's not spotted out. MXG at half health should be first dragon to Master 3.
Clever stuff here from M3. You know, they did lose the first blood, but I think they'll take the trade here of the first dragon. And Condi, we talk about needing to apply early pressure and get things done. No kills just yet for him, but a first dragon's going to be just fine.
Yeah, Alistair thinks about face checking. It doesn't know how many members to expect. Probably has a rough time, and now that Master 3 picked up the first dragon. We mentioned they had the mid-game scaling. Looks like this is probably the minimum they can hope to get in the early game. No turrets down just yet, but still control, in fact, massive control of this bottom lane.
I think Lei being level 5 there as well is also another thing. It's a galaxy of difference for Alistar when he has his ulti and when he doesn't. And, you know, you talk about face-checking somewhere blind as Alistar. Don't really want to do that without the ultimate ready.
In a lot of scenarios, Alistar just doesn't have the same effectiveness when his ult is either down or not available. If you have these situations where you rotate your AD carry down bot and you say, okay, 4 members versus 5, we can freeze in the middle. Alistar changes that because he can tank the turret for days and cause a very aggressive turret dive. But when you're level 5, you just have to watch and really wait for that experience to come through.
Yeah, just hanging out for now as Dade will clear out a watch. Zhao actually backing, but no vision there for Dade. I mean, he'll actually start a roam. Nope, never mind. Returns there to farm up the land as Condi's actually the one tipping into the top side.
Always had to be a farm best in mid. That's a lot of aggression.
Going in there, good knockback there. Let me get kicked out of it as well, but he does have his ultimate. Good patience there from Hecarim to keep himself safe.
Doesn't have the damage without the warrior enchant to really dive. It was good moves from Condi to go for the very early kick. With the ultimate still available, didn't kick him out of it. I don't know if that's a possible interaction.
No.
But the result, going to get some proxy farm on, but no kill pressure.
Yeah, Hecarim brutally immune to CC in the middle of his ulti. It's part of the reason. It's A, a good escape tool, and B, just such a good initiation tool.
There's no unstoppable in the word, so you never know for sure.
That's true. It's only an onslaught, so we have to check. But can confirm Hecarim immune to CC during his ultimate, which is part of the reason we've seen all of this smite teleport or ignite teleport shenanigans initially as Dade. Blue buff now, Athene's done as well. Xiaohu matching that with the same item there as well as Woosh. Gonna clear out the Grump, get some damage down. Lei really desperate for this level 6, let me tell you, but he'll get it relatively soon here, get some good experience, does actually ding 6 off the camp, and early items starting to get accrued by both sides.
And while it's nice for him to hit level 6, when he's just sitting in lane in this particular situation, honestly, it doesn't really change much about the lane matchup. When he exits lane, maybe he can go for the very aggressive flash pulverize into the back line, but for now, with his flash down especially, just watching SMLZ have his run of this lane.
And you can see as well, it's just paying off so nicely for the Kalista, getting all the CS she wants there. 122 to 96 CS. So the Woosh will catch up nicely as all these crash into the turret. Turret almost down there in the bottom side as well, so M3 got good options as they move around for their second dragon, and we're going to have a bit of a farm fest coming through as both teams look for the next big objective, but a couple minutes time and M3 feel like they've got control over the early game.
Yeah, I don't know if the item timings will really guarantee them the second dragon. Not going to be a Hurricane certainly by that point, just the Bloodthirst are likely to be completed next by SMLZ. Dade's 10 CS ahead has been an item completion ahead throughout the complete nature of this melee matchup. Will be a structure coming down, though, for Master 3.
Yeah, it's those turrets that are giving them such a nice lead. We talk about Hecarim needs to really charge up and get to that mid to late stage of the game. And Looper right now, with all those very effective spells and early base stats, getting the early turret as MLXG comes in. Dade will get knocked back, but Condi missing his Q, not going to have any other action.
Yeah, not a lot of damage coming to Dade as well. Doesn't even force him out of lane. Can just happily wave clear, keep that 10 CS advantage up. Going to be the first towards that needlessly large rod power spike that we often see straight afterwards. Looper's back stopped.
Yeah, a bit of an awkward spot to back there as Gragas actually caught him out. Hecarim going to come in, finds the ulti there. Looper just managed to get his ult off before it happens. Good double knockback, but Zhao is here as well for some extra speed. Shockwave going to land in there as well. Kill will go to Letmi and Looper. That was a very silly spot to recall.
Yeah, they had the choice of people to donate the kill over to. Thought it might be Zhao, but still much the same requirement for Letmi to get towards this late game. 43 CS behind. Probably best to help the horse that was really struggling in that 1v1 matchup.
Yeah, and actually, SMLZ also quite ahead in his lane as well. So, 2 games for 2 now here for M3. 2 different solo laners, or 2 different core heroes, have gotten themselves very strong and a very good CS lead here. The big lead there for Looper, which you only just noticed as you pointed it out. And SMLZ with about 20 CS ahead, maybe make it 30 plus a turret as he takes out the bottom side.
He's sitting on a pile of gold as well. He crucially hasn't shot, but 1 minute 44 to Dragon cannot fault him for being a little bit greedy at this point. I'm going to be at least Boots and a Bloodthirster, you'd have to think, or maybe even most of a Hurricane. Kind of has his choice here, does SMLZ?
Well, important time to back his Dragon. Back in a minute, 30 Berserker Greaves. And the Bloodthirster are going to be some good power. Even a Dagger, actually, spare is some nice power coming into that next fight. Dade did back for his need to see a large roll. Doesn't actually have Boots at all, so kind of relying on his long range to keep him safe at M3. We talk about them needing to gear up for the second Dragon fight, and it's up very soon.
He has Flash, so of course the Explosive Cast. You can at least flash that ability and stay in the back line. But you're right, risky to not have Boots, but thinking that he won't need it, anchoring into a defensive spot around the Dragon, and it's raining damage from the back.
Yeah, that's what he wants to do. Hecarim ulti will be back in time. In fact, both teleports there as well for the top laners. There's 55 seconds now till the Dragon does come in. Dade going to clear out the waves nicely as Xiaohu trying to find a foothold, as pretty much both teams just wanted to clear out some vision and try and get a foothold on that next big objective.
The big difference between Woosh and SMLZ in terms of items, the Bloodthirster, whatever you can say. Looper's being caught out again. 35 seconds till Dragon.
Yeah, Maokai not that tanky here at this stage. Great ult now from MLXG coming in. Let me pops him back with a devastating charge as well. There's just so much CC coming from this Gragas. Condi here, but can't do anything. And that's another kill for Let Me.
See, defensive pings around mid.
Good cleanse there from Xiaohu as Love CD nails him with the hook, so that will not be available next time.
It's weird to see both Sivir and Alistar transition towards the top of the map with Dragon up. I thought maybe they were looking to push down this turret to answer a Dragon, but regardless of everything, Master 3 definitely better set up to pick up the Dragon.
Let Me has his Skirmisher Saber and the Homeguard Mercury Treads done as well. So good options also coming through for RNG. The next Dragon fight might be a bit closer than we thought here, as it's up real soon. In fact, it's alive now.
Yeah, it's alive now. They've got position on it to Master 3. They're going to take the Skardle Crab at a minimum. And Hecarim's out of the base, picking up red buff. He can pick up red buff and get this home guard. A lot of burst damage coming on, specifically onto Dade, if they can get onto this no boots control mate.
But speaking of Dade, he's really laying in the poke there, just through that very thin choke point. Lantern as well to help reposition, and that Rend gonna give an easy second Dragon to M3.
Lots of attack speed. Doesn't have the Rend set potential so much without the Hurricane, but certainly does. A lot of Dragon securing. Dade can go back to Wave Clear Wars, which he's quite happy to do. And in general, Master 3. In a very comfortable position, in an unassailable lead, no, but in a comfortable position that they honestly needed to make this team comp work.
Yeah, about 1,500 gold or so ahead, maybe a bit under there for M3. They'll take the turret, that'll actually pop them back up. No, where'd the turret go? It's top lane, actually. Let Me able to take that one out. So 2-for-1 now in the turret score. Gonna even that gold right back up to about 500 ahead. So it's slow and steady once again for M3, but it was a mid-game where they really started taking over, and if they don't take over in the next couple minutes, RNG have some really strong tools, especially with the Hecarim starting to get going.
It's the kills that are actually keeping RNG in this game. I was trying to work out where the ace in the hole was in terms of extra gold, because they're not far behind whatsoever. It's the three kill credit, score kill credit, and critically, it's all gone on to Let Me, who was 45 CS, 47 CS behind, now he's crept up to only 20 CS behind and 2-0-1. So Achi's going to be on basically equal footing with Looper after he's overextended a couple of times too many.
Yeah, and he's got his Phage up now as well, getting stronger there. Luden's Echo going to be the next item for Xiaohu with an Aether Wisp already completed. Woosh already has his Avarice Blade and the Infinity Edge done as well. And MLXG might have caught Condi here in the Lee Sin pick. Actually going to get aggressive, but Gragas just so tanky, whacks away with the Drunken Rage and just nothing this Lee Sin can do.
In the dueling, double Cinderhulk, there's no way that Lee Sin can out-damage a Gragas. Just has better base damage on his spells. In fact, has more guaranteed damage. Just popping that Drunken Rage for a bit of percentage health. They're looking to steal away this red.
Good hook there onto MLXG. I'm going to follow it in with the flare, but Love CD now caught out with the Gragas ulti. Great Phase call to get him out from under the shockwave. Goes back in as well. Dade coming through with a death cap as Condi dives back in, but is forced to flash over the ridge. Does get himself to safety. SMLZ scout to get what he can, but Looper couldn't quite make it into the fight, doesn't want to use his teleport, and narrowly escapes death there, does Love CD.
Yeah, the timing on the Fates call by SMLZ was so good, clearly very practiced on this champion, literally fizzled the Orianna ultimate. They were just looking for one member. They were probably surprised to see going for the assassin play with trying to pick up one kill, but they knew they could transition that into multiple objectives. But even without getting a kill, That is a completely a red side jungle of Master 3 littered with wards by RNG.
And you know what? They need to as well because they're behind two dragons right now. Baron just going to spawn now as well. Probably not going to see it right at the 20-minute mark, but it was an assertive Baron that got M3 really ahead in game number one. So it has to be on these players' minds. I think EDG have shown the way. If you're confident in this Baron call, you're in a good enough position that you can take it, you just take over the game from 25 minutes.
The reason why EDG don't play a lot of champions like Xerath, though, his damage prowess around Baron, not really respectable. Kalista, fantastically good at Baron, but the other members of the team don't really suit them to picking up that objective at any sort of speed. Certainly not a Cassio when it comes to Baron damage is Xerath.
And a bit of a standoff here actually is supports and junglers trying to gank respective AD carries. Let me even running down to the bottom side of the map as well. Looper still with the teleport, sticking in the top lane as long as he can, just farming away, but could be a bloodbath here in the bottom side. Even Xiaohu starting to roam as well.
Could be five members of RNG committed. We can see Letmi in the back of this fight.
Yep. There's actually SMLZ gonna get headbutted back in. Massive damage gonna give him the first kill. Second one will come through as well. And Looper far too late here as Condi gets ulted by Hecarim. Good kick there. Might leave Wush under the turret, but it's not enough as Looper coming down as well. Xiaohu's roamed in. Dade gonna try and keep them off the turret, but two of those bolts did not hit, and that turret's dead.
Unfortunately, Looper's been really off form this game. Caught in the enemy jungle twice, and now his teleport is far too late, honestly. Should have just not channeled it, just tried to push in a wave to give a bit of global pressure. They're continuing with the aggression.
They're gonna go in. No, Looper does get to back away, but that'll be a second turret here as Gragas throws out a zoning barrel. Xiaohu's gonna go back home and whoosh on the Sivir. We've seen it before. Does do quite the damage to structures here, and that's three turrets to two now for RNG, including a tier two, although Dade gonna equalize it with the mid turret.
Yeah, once Dade showed in mid, they were just really empowered to go for a kill in a turret, or at least at minimum as they secured an inner turret. Dade moves away, gonna pick up a pink ward, but still, the smallest of advantages to take, but Master 3, it's Baron time.
They're apparently really just taking EDD's philosophy to the limit here. 22 minutes this time on the Baron, and they do have the Kalista. I don't think RNG expected, and the pink ward's there. The Baron's going down quite quickly, and M3, another very sneaky, and I'll say it, EDG tier Baron once again.
This is really, really assertive play from Master 3 around the Baron. It won them the first game, although they'd already set themselves up in a lot of ways for the victory. This is a game where they were actually looking smarting and being on the back foot, but now this Baron might unsettle the RNG game plan. King as a team were never strong around the Baron. Gamti weren't either. So unfortunately, that hasn't changed. And Master 3, they're the ones to really develop a new objective side to their game.
Yeah, very objective focus there. And rushing down that Baron, going to give them plenty of setup to get ready for the next dragon as well. 40 seconds until Master 3's third dragon will be available. Void stuff almost completed for Dade. Hurricane done now for SMLZ. Decent tank items or no major items completed for either Lee Sin or Maokai. But Master 3, dragon up in 25 seconds. They're really ready to fight.
Definitely in prime position to pick it up. It's not unassailable. They're still behind and goal. In fact, they haven't even picked up a single kill credit in the game. 0-6 is the kill score. But you mentioned it already. Bloodthirster Hurricane, the early game core is completed for SMLZ. All the summoner spells up on the carries, at least between Dade and SMLZ. The item timings are just fine. They picked up gold where they can. Very hard to opt into a dragon fight against Baron.
I think Dade doing the right thing as well, just pushing the mid wave in constantly to give them a bit more vision and put pressure onto Royal Never Give Up. Kalista with the smite there as well from Condi should be more than enough to take the next dragon. And that's straight on top of it. Dade moves towards his team now as they pick it up safely, but RNG don't even walk near the objective this time.
Yeah, Dade had to give up pressure around mid. He was worried about being dove. They don't want to give away this turret.
He gets ulted instead. Lay there gets on top of him. Massive ulti there comes in, and Lay will get that kill. Looper diving into the back as Lovesity is forced to flash out of it. Does Dade whoosh, though? Looper's going to be the next target, and objectives maybe not a thing, but team fights they are winning.
Yeah, Dade had a wonderful flash to win a 1v1 against Xiaohu in the previous game. Needed to flash that shockwave. The moment that he went down, Baron buff be damned. Master 3 were put to the sword by RNG, and they're going to continue to lose objectives.
Yeah, they're going to get more out of this. The Baron up minions not quite enough to hold it off here in RNG. A fifth turret now for them as Condi lands a Q, but will not follow that one in to the rest of Royal Never Give Up. And Letmi had a Trinity Force. That was one of the big go buttons there in that last fight, and you talked about it. The Gold League was even in that last fight, now fairly far ahead for RNG. And M3, objective control is great, but that was a silly spot to put themselves in.
Well, to say Letmy's gone for a greedy build is an understatement, but it's so easy to justify when you're 4-0-5. You have 100% kill participation as a top laner. We remember how awful his laning phase was. Looper got caught once, Looper got caught twice. The items started to pile up for Letmy. And 10 minutes after what was looking like a really tough game for Hecarim, he is now super powered this game.
Yeah, Letmy only gets stronger from this point. In fact, goes back and gets a Spectre's Cowl to go along with those Mercury Treads. So already starting to get the tank items as well. We've seen Hecarim as a good counter to Kalista SMLZ. He's already so worried about this horse.
And you can tell his priority from the pickup. If he built armor, he was going for Dada. If he builds magic resist, he's trying to kill that Kalista.
Yeah, because he wants to wade through all the magic damage there as well. And SMLC, no real good peel tools here, especially with a nice flank teleport. So RNG, win conditions firmly in place now, and they're 5,000 gold ahead.
Just really smart, assertive play to not be bullied out by the Baron. Still see the kill that was just presented on a silver platter by Dade's mispositioning. He was smart in the first to move towards the dragon, even though he wanted to wave clear and understand that between Hecarim, Gragas, Sivir, Alistar, there were so many ways to get onto the fairly immovable long-ranged mage, Xerath. But then he just walked back to lane the most aggressive way possible, and the shortest distance was picked off, and the advantage is pile on for RNG. It's 9-0 in kills.
It's boots one Dade as well, so he said he had his flash up, clearly didn't respect the cooldown there and paid for it, and in fact his team paid quite a lot as a result, so Royal Never Give Up starting to pressure a bit more proactively now. Woosh getting strong with three items. Luden's Echo's done for Xiaohu now as well. I don't want to talk about the Hecarim because he's only getting better from this point onwards. Everything's going right now for Royal Never Give Up. It's just a matter of how they close out the game, and can they arrest the Dragon? That's the big thing M3 still have going for them. MLXG, it eats a hook, but he's so tanky.
It's going to be so tough to take dragons when both Dade and SMLZ are going to have to be positioned on the polar opposite sides of the map and just have their finger so trained on the flash button, because one of these initiation tools will be used to take out both of these champions that fairly immovable, don't have natural escapes, have to use that flash summon as well as flash down. No chance you're going to opt into objectives, and honestly, hard to team fight for both of them.
And when Dade's not there as well, that wave clear, not really there. I mean, SMLZ can try, but a little too dangerous to stick your head out that far forward in a lane. So Looper's down the bottom, trying to keep Letmy going, who at this point as well, also a split push threat.
I mean, Looper's just trying to clear minions. He cannot do anything to Letmy whatsoever. This Hecarim, I'm going to pick up jungle camps with Smite. Now he can even clear wards, that's cute, and happily pick up whatever he can. Letmy's basically gone straight off the deep end when he was in the pocket of Looper early in the game. There was a big CS advantage for Looper. He had everything working until he went for that aggressive back that we've noted a couple of times. And things snowball quickly for a Hecarim.
They do indeed, and Letmy been unleashed now on the pony. And Letmy's best performances from last season, in my mind, were carry performances on champions like Kassadin and Hecarim. Seems to fit his playstyle to a T, and this, if he continues in this fashion, already at 4-0-5 with that 100% kill participation that you brought up already, be another carry performance again.
And there's a lot of top laners on this roster. Godlike, previously Ackerman, that fans will remember from LMQ, played in the Season 3 World Championships for Royal Club on the bench. Sky, a very consistent top laner from King, on the bench. Letmy, honestly, his KDA didn't really show the potential that he has, but like Xiaohu, is really respected as one of the future top laners from China. It's a big boom for him to be chosen of the three top lanes to be the starting one, and he's justifying it with play like this.
He is indeed, and objectives are coming back up now as well as we move in towards our next tension point. 40 seconds here for Baron, a minute 5 there on that dragon, and items are there for M3, but the team comp might not be because RNG just have all the tools.
Yeah, the Baron buff, that was the one part where you're like, okay, maybe they can snowball from here, but then they lost the next fight. They lost objectives with the Baron. I think that succinctly tells you how the last 5 minutes gone, and then Dade has to proactively flash.
Yeah, respects the initiation, but Lay's gonna come back in. Does charge through there with the Righteous Glory, but Love City keeps you on. Now Hecarim teleports and dives in there. That's 3 out of 4 initiations they've dodged. Can they dodge the rest of them?
Well, it's a flash down on Dade and the displacement down on Condi, so the re-engage can happen at any time for RNG. They've got exclusive vision around the Baron, and they're just looking to fight.
MLXG again, fairly tanky, gonna happily face tank the pink ward and clear it out despite the poke that's coming through. And then MLXG gonna dive in, goes in onto Looper, moves down back in. Massive shockwave and Hecarim ulti getting them all through. A three-man pulverize is not enough as SMLZ kiting back for his life. Looper caught in the front lines now as well. Will go down also. And a 3-0 teamfight win with a double kill. RNG go off with the wombo.
The ability to construct a Sivir Hecarim comp with last pick is just should never happen in competitive league. Dade was already being a bit optimistic with the Xerath lock-in, but when you add in the Sivir with last pick, it makes all these things that honestly give Dade real headaches as Xerath. Any immovable mage against the likes of Hecarim and Gragas, which are already locked in, is going to have a bad day. But when it becomes reliable with the on-the-hunt speed, it's just a bridge too far. So RNG going to go back, pick up the Baron as well. And this is nothing Master can do. They can go pick up a fourth dragon, but this game is probably not going to last another 6 minutes.
I don't think so. We've seen games end before the fifth dragon before. That Baron's going to push them up to basically 10,000 gold ahead. And Condi and SMLZ, nice hop in there from SMLZ, gets him into the pit. They'll take the dragon. That is their fourth, but Royal never give up. They're looking to end that next game.
Oh, good. I was watching RNG. They were thinking about coming down to dragon. They don't. So fourth dragon something. It's probably not going to mean enough. It's really nice play from MLXG to get onto Dade, and just the tip of the shockwave comes through. Dade dies instantly, and it doesn't matter what you can do. Whoosh, that's why we see so much Sivir. You pop the on the hunt, you can always be in the position you need to be. Your tanks are all empowered. Alistar, Hecarim, Gragas, all so much more effective when they just basically get a free ghost.
And that's the nicest thing about empowering your tanks as Sivir, is that empowers you as a very short-range AD carry. Sivir, you know, not that good as far as long-range attrition wars go with AD carries, but you're moving forward in practically melee range and you are doing damage.
That's why I always say that Sivir fights with her tanks, just because that's what she gets to do. Her tanks are all being able to do what they do do. It's not damage, it's CC, so they're all reliably hitting their CCs, hitting their skill shots because they're so quick. And Sivir's just standing with them. You have to respect the CC and the ranges that all those tanks provide, and Sivir free hit since why she's come back in this Cinderhulk meta so strongly.
And it's been such a priority pick here. It makes sense that Woosh is going to go back to it here. Played it in game one, I believe, and couldn't find a win, but up 4-0-6, looking quite a bit stronger here in this one, and so are the rest of Royal Never Give Up. Not much left here in this game for M3. If they can get to a fifth dragon, that might be what they need to keep themselves in this game, but they have to weather one hell of a storm now.
I think it's more picks, pastry time. I think even with a fifth dragon, the team comp just doesn't work. There's no way Dade can stay alive with that with Flash down. Honestly, RNG, if they can get this cask onto Dade, just kill him and dive a fight.
Yeah, I mean, they've got ultimates back up here. Everything available if they want to dive in here, and they've got all the tools to do so. Even the Baron going to help in. Let me get caught. That's not the best news, but not enough damage to kill him.
It doesn't have Home Guard, so Home Guard teleport's not a realistic option. They bought some time here of Master 3. Fifth Dragon might spawn and give them a glimmer of hope, but for now, it's just wave clear.
Yeah, got to deal with the super minions here. Massive stack in the bottom side as well. Going to have Alistar wander towards there as Condi, trying to find a window there under Lee Sin. Will clear them out as best he can. No major objectives here means RNG have to calm down just a little bit with the Hecarim getting chunked out, but Letmy's back in. He's gone home, healed up, got some more items, and then run back to the mid, and we're going to look for a dive once more.
And Master 3, they get a bit of time. You might think, okay, they can farm up and get some items, but this is Kalista we're talking about. She's pretty much capped at 3 items. There's no Critical Strike modifier to encourage an Infinity Edge purchase. Dade's had his core for quite a while between these 3 items. Might need to consider maybe he's going to pick up some movement speed with the Aether Wisp. Might have even considered the Distortion Boots, because when his Flash is on cooldown, not really much he can contribute. Everyone on this team doesn't really get stronger with the items or time, and RNG just gets stronger and stronger.
You can see Dade going to try and poke up Xiaohu, actually, but doesn't take too much damage. Baron minions doing work. It's taking their time. That's one of the things their comp doesn't do that well is Siege, I think. They've got good turret damage, but it'll take a while with the Baron up minions doing pretty much all of the work. But if they want to dive, they can dive. If they want to fight, they can fight. And they don't need to do too much other than what they're doing. And I looked up, M3 still don't have a kill.
Between Gragas and Alistar, pastry time, they can either bounce people away from a turret and take it fast with a Sivir, or just have Alistar take the turret aggro and 12-0. Grim reading.
It is indeed. I mean, it looked fine before with the 3 dragons up and a couple towers and a Baron there as well. But since then, it's all objectives for M3 and all kills, and now all objectives for RNG as well. Dragons be damned. They don't need it to win this game, it looks like.
They don't need it. I don't even know if the 5th dragon will really mean that much. Just the scaling isn't there with the teams. Looks like Blade the Ruined King is going to be the next pick to just from MSMLZ. Probably not going to get to complete it. Woosh. So strong on the Sivir. 4 damage items complete. Doesn't really need to rush in terms of any magic resort or anything, because there's just no real threat coming through from Master 3 onto Sivir.
You're taking, again, a little bit more time to close out this game, kind of like game number one, but Royal never give up, know that they can play safely, feel confident in the scaling of their comp as well, and this position, like we mentioned, very difficult for M3 to assail. And let me, he's hanging out in home, just waiting for a good teleport.
Still 100% kill participation.
I mean, that says so much about how good this Hecarim has been for Royal this particular game. Waveclear back in there. Baron Buff has worn off, I believe, so he's going to slow down the siege just a bit. But again, they just need to pull the trigger once here with a reasonably clean fight, and that'll be it for M3, unfortunately.
Honestly, Gragas should get a Sightstone Ward, as he's trying to do, into the base. Once that happens, just have the Hecarim rush in and get the kill. Don't know how many Sightstone wards he has left, but they just need to get a ward into the base to really empower a very good teleport to come through from Hecarim.
I mean, they can force here as well. There's an inhib open. Condi dives in way too deep, but MLXG actually going to use the ultimate to sort of push him back away. Hecarim still waiting. Lay's going to dive in. There's a teleport coming through. Xiaohu's going to move in. Love City gets Fates called out after getting initiated on, and Letme just needs to dive in, but Looper turns him around. Good hook there from Love City as well, just trying to buy time, but RNG, they'll take the inhib instead. Dadi doing what he can, but it's not enough. He
hits three bolts onto Woosh. One of them prompts a spell shoot. There's the initiate.
Letme goes in. Dadi in trouble. Love City gonna ride in as well. Dade gonna try and keep himself alive. Good lantern, but Woosh crits him and he dies instantly there. Love City finds another grab, but it's too little too late here for M3. Boomerang Blade almost gonna get Love City. Flay's gonna try and keep him alive, but Lay, good pulverize, so good headbutt into double pulverize coming in. Hook lands again. Shockwave gonna kill Looper of all people, and Royal never give up. They've taken the game, and that's a 1-1 split for the series.
It looks like they'll be able to finish this game. Dade got counterpicked once as Lay goes in again.
Yeah, I mean, just cleaning up some more kills. Good combos there from Alistar, showing off a bit as SMLZ tries as he might to do something, but that's just another kill for Gragas. Doesn't quite, or does end the game with 100% kill participation. Will this Hecarim and Letme, what a show here in their second game.
And to me, it was a tale of two counterpick space time. Picked the Vladimir confidently, the Dade, won the matchup in a counterpick matchup. Picked the Xerath, which is a fine laning matchup against the Orianna opponent. But the Sivir just meant that he basically counterpicked himself in terms of comp and just expertly played. Only one kill finally coming through for Master 3 right at the last, and they split the points, and honestly, on the basis of those two games, a fair result.
I think so too. I mean, we had a lot of questions for both teams. What does M3 look like recharging? It turns out when they get controlled again, they look quite good, but what is this? Again, I'm going to say new team, even though the players are very familiar. As a five-man unit, they've never been together, I believe, playing all on the same side. So it was going to be different for both sides here. Royal Never Give Up showed that some of the hype behind them is, you know, top-level solo queue players and strong LPL contenders from last season can look good together. But certainly as we start the season for both teams, a lot of growing up to do for both of them.
Exactly. No big debut like QG yesterday where you say, okay, this is a new team. They could really assault the top spots. Probably going to be pushing for playoff contention, but not necessarily right at the top for either of them. When Dade looks good, though, so do Master 3. And RNG, they're just getting everything together. It's a new lineup. They're putting it together. There's a lot of potential there, and they're starting to register.
Yeah, they are indeed. Almost expected split there at the end of the day, but we do have one more game coming up. Your MSI champions, Edward Gaming, are going to take on some new, a very, very familiar